A little tiny bit busy.
Okay. You will find it when you get to do that. I think the key of B flat you will find user
Oh
friendly.
yes, I love the key of B flat.
Yeah,
The other
that's
one
good.
is F sharp, the one with one sharp, F,
Oh,
whatever.
that's G
G,
major.
G,
G
yep.
major, right? Yeah.
Because
Well, yeah.
it makes sense to call it to have an F sharp in a G scale. I know it makes some bizarre sense, but I haven't figured it out yet.
I see where you're coming from, you know.
Wouldn't be the F sharp scale, F sharp or no.
No. Well, speaking of music, it's 9:20, and Amy, if you're ready to go, I am ready to go.
I have muted everyone. If you will unmute yourself, Ken, you're good to go.
Well, good morning, friends, on the last Sunday of Epiphany. For my prelude this morning, I have chosen three Old English voluntaries. A voluntary is a thing that a word they came up with in England a long time ago, that the organ voluntarily plays a piece of music, usually before and after. So I'm going to play one in D minor by Henry Heron. There's a slow and a fast movement. And then an air by Samuel Wesley, and then a second voluntary by William Walland in G major. Again, it has a slow intro followed by a quick part. They are wonderfully happy music, and I hope you find it such. I refer to this type of music as ear ticklers. Thank you.
Thank you. Respond, ye souls in endless rest, ye patriots and prophets blessed. Alleluia, alleluia. In knowledge well be martyrs strong, O saints triumphant praise the song. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Oh, friends in gladness, let us sing, supernal anthems echoing. Alleluia, alleluia. To God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, three in one. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
From the rising of the sun to its setting, my name shall be great among the nations. And in every place, incense shall be offered to my name in a pure offering. For my name shall be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia.
The Lord, the God of gods, has spoken. He has called the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting.
Out of Zion, perfect in his beauty, God reveals himself in glory.
Our God will come and will not keep silence. Before him there is a consuming flame, and round about him a raging storm.
He calls the heavens and the earth from above to witness the judgment of his people.
Gather before me, my loyal followers, those who have made a covenant with me and sealed it with sacrifice.
Let the heavens declare the rightness of his cause, for God himself is judge.
A reading from the second book of Corinthians. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the God whom heaven and earth adore, from men and from the angel host, be praise and glory evermore.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, but they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.
May we live so others know your gospel truths are true. Bring God's love to places where it has not yet arrived. Bask in Christ's light, and in doing so, shine bright. Amen. Welcome to one of those rare moments in liturgical time when two holidays combine into one. Dear ones, happy Valentine's Day and happy Transfiguration Sunday. For most, Valentine's Day takes center stage, ranked fifth overall of the top shopping holidays. But remember, before Valentine's Day belonged to Hallmark, it belonged to the church. Originally, a pagan holiday, Lupercalia, was celebrated on February 15th, a festival when Roman priests would sacrifice a goat, take and make long strips of goat hide, dip them in blood, and then men would use them to slap women and crops, hoping to encourage them into better fertility patterns. No surprise, these traditions were deemed unchristian. So in the 5th century, Pope Gelasius replaced Lupercalia with Valentine's Day. Valentine, patron saint of epileptics, lovers, and beekeepers. It is listed on the Church of England's religious calendar, but not the Episcopal or Roman Catholic religious calendars. In 1969, the Pope quietly dropped Valentine from the list of vetted saints because of a lack of reliable information. Honestly, when it comes to Saint Valentine, we have only glimpses of holy glory, fragments of his life story. Was there one Valentine or two? History says there was a priest, Valentine of Rome, and a bishop, Valentine of Terni. Or were they just one and the same? People move around, don't they? History tells us Emperor Claudius II struggled to encourage men to become soldiers, blamed ties to wives and children, so he banned all marriages and engagements. And legend says Valentine defied the emperor by helping many couples tie the knot in secret. Another legend tells us how Valentine saw two lovers quarreling, gifted them a rose, then reinvigorated their love by having several, not doves, but affectionate pigeons circle around them, hence the phrase lovebirds. Finally, the best known and loved story of Valentine tells how he was imprisoned, fell in love with his jailer's blind daughter, healed her, converted the whole family, then wrote and sent a note to the girl from prison signed, "Your Valentine," and then was tortured and beheaded on February 14th. Was Valentine beheaded for marrying people against the emperor's will or making new Christians? We don't know. Fact is, long before the poet Geoffrey Chaucer declared Valentine's Day was the chance to honor romance, well before those in the Middle Ages and Lynn Marino's dad, a Kentucky farmer, declared that February 14th is the day birds choose their mates, Valentine was the man who said God's plan was this: transfigure through the power of love. Before Lent begins every year, we hear not just a host of alleluias, but also the story of Jesus's transfiguration. We hear it from one of three gospels, either Matthew, Mark, or Luke. Just line up all three through a parallel Bible study and see how much they have in common. Peter, James, and John hike up a mountain with Jesus. Jesus is transfigured. Elijah and Moses appear. Peter says, "Let's build three booths." A cloud covers them. God speaks. Elijah and Moses vanish. And then Jesus tells the disciples to zip their lips. After reading, it's all too easy to shrug our shoulders and think the story irrelevant. Why does it even matter that these three saw Jesus shine so bright? Baffled, as usual, by this text, I decided to read Andreas Andropoulos's iconic book on transfiguration and was impressed by this observation. To the extent that transfiguration means a change of something into something that it was not before the change, the actual transfiguration happened in Peter, James, and John, not in Jesus. Truth. Jesus never changed on that mountain. He was who he always was. Mark makes this truth abundantly clear throughout his gospel. At his baptism, we hear Mark tell us that God said, "You are my son, my beloved." At his crucifixion, a Roman soldier confesses, "Truly, this man was God's son." And at this mountaintop moment, God declares, "This is my son, my beloved." Jesus keeps being Jesus. What changed was the disciples, who chose to have their eyes wide open. The curtain of humanity was lifted, and they were gifted to see fully his divinity. As the Celtic saying goes, heaven and earth are only 3 feet apart, but in thin places, that distance is even shorter. At this thin place moment, something special happened. Peter acknowledged that with his outburst. He's dismissed as foolish, rambling. But we've all been there, where Peter was, had our breaths taken away by a moment that stuns and stupefies us. Charles Wesley's hymn has been felt and sung not just on our lips, but in our lives. Love divine, all love excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down, fixed in us, thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. The birth of a baby, seeing the love of our life walk down the aisle towards us to mate. The graduation of a child, now adult. The perfect glint of powdered snow as we go down a mountain on skis with our family. We have all held, seen, felt, all will be well, singular moments. We've all sensed heaven on earth. We've all had glimpses of divine glory in our own holy stories. Many years ago, I actually visited Mount Tabor in Israel, the mountain where many believe the transfiguration took place. I honestly remember nothing about the hike up the mountain, the two churches on top. I do remember stopping and shopping for an olive wood statue. The seller, a man, spoke in broken Italian, and the buyer, a seminarian, me, spoke in broken Latin. And somehow, completely unknown, I don't know how, we understood each other fully. We chattered away, laughing and bartering, and we ended our time together holding hands and praying and saying the Our Father. Him in Italian, me in English. I will never forget standing with that fellow believer and feeling so light, so grateful, so unexpectedly transfigured. Transfiguration cannot, unfortunately, be scheduled. And yet, as Christians, grounded in hope, we believe transfiguration moments will come. We've had them before, and we'll have them again. When we most need them, and always when we least expect it. So, faithful friends, this day I say to you, just do your part to open your eyes and your hearts to these moments. Find the time to look out the window. Listen to a bird's cry. Give thanks for the loves of your life. Count your blessings more than your burdens. And most importantly, carve out time and space to be with your Creator. My dear Valentines, never forget the power of Christ's love is in you. My dear disciples, the power to transfigure others is in you. Amen. Let us join together in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The Word of God calls us to see that all the places and occasions of the world, even places of sorrow and death, are transfigured by the presence of the glory of God in Christ Jesus. let us now call to mind all who are in any need and commend them to God's transforming care, saying, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For those who are alone, for widows and widowers and orphans, and for the divorced, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For the imprisoned, for those whose only home is the streets, and for those caught by addiction, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For the hungry, for those who cannot feed their children, and for the unemployed, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For refugees, for the victims of warfare, and for those held in poverty by racial discrimination, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For the people of our nation, our city, and our community, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For artists and writers, and for all who think on the edge of society, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For preachers and teachers of the light-bearing word of Christ, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For the church and its leaders, formed by the life-giving word of Christ, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
For this assembly, feeding on the word of Christ, O merciful God,
hear our prayer.
With Moses and Elijah and all the people of God, with the church throughout the ages bearing witness to the great light of God shining in dark places, we commend to you all for whom we pray, O merciful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I invite everyone to take hold of their keyboards and type in your prayers and cares and lift them up to God. Dwight offers prayers for healing for Ron, Chrissy, Nancy, Steve, Paul, Jeff, Patty, Jen, Mateo, Teddy, Olaf, and Clark. Tammy Visalo offers prayers for her friend Tom and all others who are dealing with depression. Shelly Kesselman offers prayers for all those for whom Valentine's Day is difficult. Amen to that. Terry Everett prays for love and hope for the homeless, struggling, and lonely. Stephen Smiley offers prayers of healing for Ned. Deb Hsu offers prayers for healing for Danielle, who underwent knee surgery. Dwight wishes a happy birthday to Ed Doyle. Nancy Ann and Dick Ferrin offer prayers of healing for Ethan, Evan, Joan, Kevin, and Pat. Don and Cheryl offer prayers for Matthew and Kelly and Cameron. Give them strength to deal with the turmoil of their reconstruction. Gail Schumann offers prayers for Nancy and Jen, both starting treatment for brain tumors. Danny Lee offers prayers that she gets through finals week for her, she wrote, class surgery, and also glad that she didn't need knee surgery after her fall the other day. I'm glad for that too. I was worried about you when you were slipping on that ice. So be careful, everyone, when you're out there. Debbie Hsu offers Thanksgiving and prayers for her dad as he turns 89 today. Tammy offers prayers for all those that want to be vaccinated as are able and timely possible. Jeff offers ongoing job hunt prayers and Thanksgiving for my sermon today. Thank you, Shelley, for saying that. Sermons are like babies. Some birth harder than others, and this one birthed hard. Barbara offers prayers for her sister's cousin who is now in rehab. Greg and Hank say, Lord God, grant us peace in our day that By the help of your mercy, we might be free from sin and safe from all distress. Chris Messier offers prayers for Susie, who is facing a cancer diagnosis. Gail Schumann offers prayers for Dodie Scharbach, who went to heaven this week, and joining prayers for her husband, Ed, and actually joining her husband, Ed, and daughter, Sue. Other prayers that I might have missed, they came pretty fast. If I missed one, you might need to type it in again because they were flying through. I ask prayers for my own family for Fiona. She has always struggled when she eats. After she eats, her stomach just hurts and it's gotten really bad. So we went to the doctor and had blood tests. So I'm just praying we figure out how to make her feel better and for her to not have chronic stomach pain every time she eats. So prayers for her, and Thanksgiving for all medical people as they continue to heal and deal with the pandemic. The Zimmermans give thanks for the New Hampshire National Guard and the EMS services and all who are giving vaccines, and including that all volunteers who are helping give out vaccines. Other prayers? Gail offers prayers. It says, she's giving me advice actually of where to go for Fiona. Thank you for that. I'll have to write it down. Other prayers? Final call. Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen.
Amen. Welcome, everybody. Good to see everyone on screen. Just a few announcements today. Again, continue. People have been doing this to email in, if you remember, things we've purchased over the past decade as we're trying to assemble an updated photo inventory for our parish. Please consider joining us this coming Tuesday at noon for our book group. One of our rules of the book group is if you haven't even read the book, you can still join us. Terry Everett also says, Happy Valentine's Day to all. So agreed, that's part of our announcements, and may you have a blessed and holy time with your loved ones and reach out to those you're not with. Don't forget, Ash Wednesday is this coming Wednesday, and we will be having ashes in the courtyard. We'll be sending reminders of this and of course Zoom invites as well, but ashes in the courtyard for anyone from 5:30 to 6:30, you can either have them imposed on your head, we'll be wearing gloves, or we can just sprinkle them on your head. And then please consider joining us for our Zoom service at 7:30 p.m. If an evening time's not great for you, we'll also be sending along, our bishop is doing a noonday service, and we'll send you those links and information as well. Additionally, Society for St. John the Evangelist, a really remarkable monastery of Episcopal men, is offering a noonday service, and I'll be sending that information along as well in the link. So you've got a lot of options of how to begin and kick off Lent. Finally, we've moved our vestry meeting to Thursday night. We usually meet on Wednesday nights, so we'll be having our vestry meeting on Thursday night this week. And don't forget, next Sunday is the first Sunday of Lent, so we will be having drive-by Eucharist and Eucharist during our worship service. Now I hand it off to our deacon.
Let us bless the Lord. And we'll say these next words for the last time for a long time. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Today's postlude music is by J.S. Bach. It's his little prelude and fugue in F major, arranged for piano by Dmitri Kabalevsky.
Everybody, feel free to say hello. Thank you, Carter. That was amazing.
You're welcome.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning, folks.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning. Good morning. Did anybody else get disconnected? I got disconnected for a minute.
Hey, Pat.
The power faded. Okay.
You're back in.